At first glance, IPv6 addresses may seem strange and different to what we're used to. In this video, I'm going to simplify things. By the end, this IPv6 address will make total sense. Let's start by comparing an IPv4 and an IPv6 address. IPv4 addresses have four groups of numbers, while IPv6 has eight. These numbers are separated by dots in IPv4 or colons in IPv6. The decimal numbers in IPv4 can range from 0 to 255. The hexadecimal numbers in IPv6 range from 0 to FFFF. We need to talk about the difference between decimal and hexadecimal before we go any further. For most of our lives, we've been comfortable using decimal numbers to count. Decimal numbers have 10 digits, 0 through to 9. Every number we make is based on these 10 digits. If we start counting from 0, we get to 9. Then what do? We add a 1 to the front and start counting again. We do the same when we reach 99, and the pattern continues. When we learned binary, we learned another way of counting. This time there are only 2 digits, 0 and 1. Which are the building blocks of all binary numbers. As with decimal, to make bigger numbers, we add more and more numbers to the front. We can see that binary and decimal are just two different ways of counting things. Hexadecimal is yet another way of counting. This time we have 16 digits, 0 through to F. As we count up, we can go past 9. The number after 9 is A, then comes B, C, and so on. F is equivalent to 15 in decimal. What happens if we want to count past F? Well, it's the same idea as decimal. We add a new column to the front and keep going. This is where it gets a little confusing. This is not 10 in decimal, this is 16 in hexadecimal. In many cases, hex numbers are shown as starting with 0x or ending with H. This is just to make it clear that this is a hexadecimal number, not a decimal number. We don't do that with IPv6 addresses though. We know they are always in hexadecimal because, well, those are clearly IPv6 addresses. Sometimes we will need to convert between decimal, hex, and binary. You can try to do that in your head if you really want to, but it's much easier just to use a calculator. For example, the Windows calculator shown here has programmer mode. We can easily type in a number and convert back and forth. In fact, here's a really good opportunity to try it out for yourself. If we look at this IP address, it seems shockingly complicated. Fortunately, there's a trick to simplify this address. We'll start with what we know. There are 8 groups of numbers separated by colon symbols. Each 16-bit block of numbers is written in hexadecimal. You'll see that some of the 16-bit groups begin with zeros. For our first trick, we can omit any leading zeros in each group. Immediately, this starts getting simpler. Next, if we see a few groups of zeros in a row, we can shorten these too. In its place, we can just put a double colon, and this really makes things a lot simpler. Let's take a look at this example. How can we simplify this address? First, find the leading zeros and remove them. Next, compress any groups of zeros. But here we have 2 groups, so what do? The rule is that we can only compress one group of zeros, not both. So we'll compress the leftmost group. That's much simpler. See, IPv6 is getting easier already. The best way to get comfortable is to practice. So try out these examples. Despite IPv6's many improvements, a lot still remains the same. We still have a concept of network and host portions of an address. The network portion is usually called a subnet, but the correct term is now prefix. In practice, both terms are fine. I'm sure you'll recognize the subnet mask at the end too. You may be more familiar with the old dotted decimal notation. Well, that's old-fashioned and not used with IPv6 anymore. We always use the CIDR format now, although technically it's now called the prefix length. The entire IPv6 address is 128 bits long. In this example, the prefix length is 64 bits, which is exactly half of the IP address. While we can use any prefix length that we want to, /64 has become the standard prefix length for most of our subnets. And this is not just my recommendation. This is official advice, which you can find in RFC 7421. A /64 allows about 18 quintillion addresses per subnet. That's huge. But that's just the way IPv6 works. If you see an address with a /128 prefix length, this is a host address. They're commonly used on loopback interfaces. This is the equivalent of a /32 in IPv4. When we use a point-to-point WAN link, we may use a /127 prefix length. I've worked with a few different service providers. Some like to use /127 on the WAN, while others prefer /64. Really, either is fine. Take note that a /127 only allows two host addresses. This means that there is no need for a network and broadcast address. This is the same as IPv4/31 addresses. You might also notice that when we write a network address, we can simply end it with a double colon. And the same is true when we write a host address. We can start it with a double colon. This is nothing fancy. It's just a nice, neat way to write it out. It helps keep our documentation tidy. Here's an interesting question. You have a list of IPs and subnets. See if you can line them up to the letters in the topology. If we put IPv4 and IPv6 headers next to each other, we can immediately see that the IPv6 header is much bigger. The obvious reason for this is that IPv6 addresses are 4 times the size of IPv4. If we dig deeper into the two header types, we can see that, although bigger, IPv6 is much simpler. There are fewer mandatory fields. Even so, they can optionally have extra extension headers if they are needed. Next, we need to consider the various types of IPv6 addresses. The next video looks at global unicast addresses, local addresses, anycast addresses, and more.